good to have you coming down the road with us. We're going to go from school bonding to comments about football to, well, we've got a big day planned for you. But we're going to begin with something that shouldn't be a problem, but is a problem. Dr. Avishnag Paul joins us. He is an infectious disease expert with Samford Hospital. Dr. Nagpal, good to have you back coming down the road with us.
Thank you, Joe.
A number of issues that we asked you to come back on for because it just doesn't seem to go away, which is the status of Samford Hospital here in the Fargo-Moorhead area. What is it? How many people do we have in the hospital? How many of those have COVID?
Yeah, so we continue to run a census of more than 500 in the hospital, closer to 550. And people with active COVID infection, there are about 35 today. And if you take into account people who remain hospitalized but are no longer considered infectious, so they are distributed throughout the hospital and not in the COVID units per se, that number goes up to about 56 or so. So about a tenth of our hospitalized patients are hospitalized because of COVID.
Have you lost any patients recently? Have you lost any to COVID?
No, Joel. You know, we continue to be patient because we know we are in this for a long run, and we don't have the luxury of losing our patients. We don't have the luxury of denying service to whoever comes through our doors. So we are hanging in there. We are trying to be as resilient as possible. Yes, we are fatigued. Yes, we are tired. Yes, we wish that we didn't have to keep dealing with this again, but we continue to march on.
Yeah. And maybe I asked the question poorly, but are people still dying from COVID?
Yes, unfortunately, yes.
Yeah.
And this is preventable.
Somewhere along the way, the medical community changed how it treats individuals with COVID. Did it not? Isn't it something where you know more about it now than what you did in the beginning?
Yeah, significantly more knowledge. You know, we were shutting down everything back in spring 2020. We didn't know what was in store for us. We didn't know what worked, what did not work. Now we have medications. Now we have vaccines, more importantly. Vaccines a lot more effective than the medications that we can give the patients. But we continue to struggle with providing education and countering misinformation regarding vaccines. So we have to talk to each and every individual personally. It takes time, it takes effort, so not a tide that we can turn overnight, but we continue to march along.
There are a lot of people who claim that, you know, when it comes to COVID, we really have a situation where even the healthcare providers themselves aren't in agreement with what that treatment should be. Is in any way, shape, or form that true?
No, not really. So, you know, there will always be outliers, which creates an illusion of debate in the medical society. But the fact of the matter is, the data is pretty clear cut. What works the best? Vaccine works the best. What works the second best? Mass and social distancing work second best. What works the third best? The medications that we have already, like Decadron or monoclonal antibodies. These are not magical drugs, but they do reduce complications and risk of death. But they do not substitute vaccinations. Our best defense against the pandemic remains the vaccination. And on these three points, there is absolutely no medical debate whatsoever.
Well, and maybe one way to show that is a figure that I think might indicate exactly why the medical community, by and large, there's always going to be one or two, by and large, is for vaccination. And that is this: with the numbers that you just gave us in your hospital, the fact that we're still losing people to COVID, what percentage or what rough number of those individuals haven't been vaccinated?
So of all the people who are hospitalized for COVID-19, about a quarter of them are vaccinated, three quarters of them are unvaccinated. And of those who have serious illness in terms of being in the ICU or requiring a ventilator, that's only one or two patients on a daily basis out of the 35 that we have in-house today.
Okay. So clearly it shows that the numbers are in your favor if you get vaccinated.
Oh, yeah, there's no doubt about that. People who are vaccinated, first of all, their risk of getting the infection is low. Even if they get the infection, their risk of getting into the hospital is very low. Even if they get into the hospital, their risk of further complications is extremely low. They have a shorter length of stay. They don't end up requiring ventilator. And patients who have died despite vaccination or have ended up on the on the ventilator despite vaccination, you can count them on your fingertips.
Dr. Nagpal, here's something that everybody works around individuals that are anti-vax, or they have them in their life. Here's one of the things that one of the individuals that I work around has told me, which is if everyone can carry COVID, if everyone can carry an infectious disease like they have, but yet because they've been vaccinated, it doesn't make them necessarily sick. And then the individuals that really have taken the approach that they don't care, that they're not going to be vaccinated, then why force vaccination on everyone? Why cause people in many instances to say, if you work here, or if you go to this school, or any other reasons that you must get vaccinated, if you can carry COVID anyway, why should you be forced to be vaccinated?
So, that argument is not based on very good logic, because then you are not then you are discounting the principles of transmission of an infection. If there are 100% people who are vaccinated, yes, there will be big breakthrough infections every now and then, but it won't cause a wave or tsunami of infections out in the community. And whenever the infection is surging, there will always be people who don't mount a response to vaccine or who have a breakthrough infection or who have underlying conditions that make them more susceptible. So those patients will end up in the hospital. So if everybody's vaccinated, we will not have a surge. You continue to break the cycle of transmission. You don't have outbreaks in a, where we have to shut down the classroom. You don't have outbreaks where we have to close down a nursing home. You don't have outbreaks in a healthcare setting where you have to close down a specific department. And healthcare is a complex system. You cannot say, for example, if I shut down a department of cardiothoracic surgery, for 10 days, if somebody has COVID, there are a lot of people gonna die, not because of COVID, just because we don't have a cardiothoracic surgeon who can operate on people who are coming in with heart attacks, or a neurologist who cannot take care of people who are coming with a stroke. So the world doesn't stop for you to complete your isolation. And we see patients who have cancer, who are on active chemotherapy, who are sick, who are very vulnerable medically speaking, or some people even socioeconomically speaking. So we cannot have outbreaks in nursing home, long-term care institutions, assisted livings, group homes, hospitals. These are the places where people come for care and to get better. We cannot have outbreak have people come into the hospital for a surgery and give them COVID. That's counterproductive to what our overall vision and mission is, to provide better care, better medical care, and improve the health of the community in general. We cannot remain we cannot be a business or a enterprise or a hospital where outbreaks emerge from. So it's a no-brainer that we have to have as many people as you need to be vaccinated. And the same goes for classroom. If there's an outbreak, there are multiple students out, you have to close the classroom for a couple of weeks. That takes away from already reduced number of school days that you have, taking into consideration all the breaks and other interruptions that happen with daily life. People need to travel. People need to visit their families. People are sick for other reasons, or you have transportation issues, or you have daycare issues. So all these things have downstream effects. No section of society is isolated in general, and that's a paradox of public health. If you don't care about a problem of a particular group or a particular individual, then very soon that problem becomes a societal problem.
So, Dr. Nagpal, what about kids? What about those 5 years and older, that range between 5-year-olds to 11-year-olds that haven't had the opportunity to be vaccinated yet? How close are we to having a vaccine that can be utilized for kids that age?
Yeah, so Pfizer has already come out and said that vaccine is safe and effective. We don't have the data publicly available yet. When it does, and then we will review it. But it's going through the normal review process through the scientific committees at FDA and CDC, and that takes about 4 weeks. And we obviously don't want to rush this process because we want the vaccine, we want to guarantee that the vaccine is safe and effective. Vaccines are the most regulated products on the planet across any industry, and we like it that way because that's how I can be sure that it's safe for my kids or my parents or my spouse. And if I think that it has not gone through the proper administration channels and proper vetting channels, then it's difficult for me to recommend the vaccine to my family. And if I cannot recommend it to my family, I cannot recommend it to my patients. So we have to make sure that the vetting process and the data review process is sound, is just, and it's complete before we release the vaccination for the kids. And that usually takes about 4 weeks, and I expect the vaccination to be available for the kids around the Halloween time.
So, Dr. Nagpal, when that comes, when that approval comes, will it have the full blessing of the Food and Drug Administration, or will it have emergency status, which is what the vaccine had when I took it? And then, of course, the emergency or the full approval of Food and Drug came later.
So it will go through the same process where it's authorized for emergency use, and then we will have follow-up period for about a year before we say that, yes, real-world experience mirrors absolutely the clinical trial experience and we are not having any long-term side effects. That's the normal process for any drug that's available to the market, and vaccines are no different. So now you've seen how vaccines have become fully authorized by the FDA, and it will be the same process for the kids. So initial authorization will be under emergency use.
Dr. Nagpal, one last question. How are you and your coworkers holding up? How are you handling all this? Men and women of science, individuals that are out there, and you're seeing, you know, people say if you're above 100 employees, for example, you will get vaccinated. And in New York City right now, they're talking about people in the medical community that won't get vaccinated, that are about to, for lack of a better way of putting it, be kicked out of the medical community. How are you and your coworkers reacting to that?
So it's heartbreaking. It seems like it's hard not to take that personally, because that feels like a defeat for us and our failure to educate our own colleagues and our own employees, and just feels like we are losing a war to misinformation. Because every time you talk to people who are not ready to get vaccinated, despite it being a job requirement, it's heartbreaking. I mean, you never hear a particular scientific reason for them not to get vaccinated. It's the same misinformation that has been part of the pandemic. Some people argue that it has not been through the process. Some people argue and that it's safe or it's not safe or it was rushed. None of that is true. We continue to have these discussions. But it does create an illusion of debate in the medical community when there is none.
Doctor, you and the wonderful people at Sanford have given us access, and you've answered questions. Unfortunately, I'm sure we're going to have to talk again, but I want you to know how much my audience and myself appreciate you taking the time. Thank you, sir.